Yasmin, you can go ahead.
Okay, sir. To all respected dignitaries, faculty members, and all the participants from various institutions, and all your students, I, Vyas from second year of the Department of Police and Special Technology, agree. First, an exclusive morning to everyone. I hope that
Speech is not clear. Speech is jumbled up.
Yasmin? Okay, you can. Hello, Yasmin? Your signal
Hello,
is not
sir.
Proper.
Sir, can I repeat again?
Yeah, you can start now. Your voice is okay, jumbling. Okay, now you can start again.
So now?
Yeah, okay. You start.
To all respected dignitaries, faculty members, and all the participants from various institutions, and all dear students, I, V. Yasmin from second year EC Department of Gates Institution of Technology, Guthi. First of all, an exquisite morning to everyone. I hope that yesterday everyone had a wonderful session on recent national and international developments in intellectual property rights domain by Dr. B. Manan sir. After this amazing session today, we are going to have an exciting and informative session on the topic intellectual property rights for business development and value addition. And I'm fortunate and I feel boundless delight and also honored to introduce Sri Dr. Bhaktavatsalu Manan sir, the resource person on intellectual property rights for business development and value addition, who has completed his Master of Technology in Satellite Communication and Remote Sensing at IIT Kharagpur, accomplished his PhD in Fuzzy Neural Networks at IIT Kharagpur, and worked as Global Manager, IP Analysis Group, Intellectual Property and Standard Division, Bangalore, 11 years at Philips Electronics Limited, and also as an Intellectual Property Analyst and IP Counsel for 3 years, and worked in Indian Air Force for 22 years as an Operations and Maintenance Engineer and as Research Scientist on Deputation to ISRO and DRDO, and so was a scientist at National Remote Sensing Center, Hyderabad for 4 years, then worked as a scientist in DRDO at DLRL for 2 years, worked as a team leader at John F. Belt Technology Center, Bangalore for 2.5 years. Sir is a patentee of one US patent and has 5 journal papers and 3 conference papers. And Manan sir has been successful part of many projects and research areas such as installation, testing, system integration, and commissioning of troposcatter telecommunication systems and voice and message switching systems for IAF, development of an image processing system, an empty project in IIT Kharagpur, and drafted 25 patent applications in video and image processing areas, and performed 300 plus patent eligibility searches in electronics, communication, and computer technologies, and an award of best performing international team in Philips Intellectual Property Standards in 2012, and also management awardee for best project in GE, JFWTC 2002, and global manager for 30 plus professionals and located in the Netherlands, China, and India in Philips IP&S for 8 years. Best maintained troposcatter unit award in the Eastern sector of IAF in 1997. So conducted more than 100 workshops, seminars, and training sessions on intellectual property in Philips Electronics, universities, and MNCs for professionals, faculty members, and students. Selection, training, and monitoring for more than 30 IP analysts in Philips Electronics, the Netherlands, India, and China. And continuous monitoring and quality assurance of outputs of 3 teams of IP analysts, and so taught engineering students and guided projects in electronics and communication engineering domain, and the fortune of Gates Institute of Technology students brought us the successful person as a professor at Gates Institution of Technology. Sir, your papers, patent, conferences, experiences, projects, researches, awards, achievements, and monitoring, teaching, experiences, positions are so inspirational and age-striking And that made us also privileged to have the honorable resource person, Sri Dr. Bhaktavatsalu Manan sir, to a 5-day online workshop on intellectual property rights. Sir, indeed, it's my immense pleasure to take the privilege in welcoming you, sir. The session is all yours, sir.
Sir, unmute yourself, sir. Unmute.
Thank you, Yasmin, for that wonderful introduction. Dear faculty members, principal, management, dear students, and all the other interested members who are attending this intellectual property rights seminar for 5 days online workshop, which is hosted by Gates Institute of Technology. I welcome one and all for this session on IPR for business development and value addition. Want a confirmation that my speech is clear? Audio is okay? Can I go ahead? Hello? Today's topic will be covered in the following subsections. Introduction to IPR for those who have joined today or those who are coming for the first time. For them, brief introduction of IPR will be in order so that they can be at par with all the other participants who are already attending for the past 3 days. Different categories of IP will be covered, just an introduction, because we have been heavily concentrating on patents and patents. And this time we will also visit some of the other important intellectual property categories and understand and know something about all the types of categories which are very important for business development. IP policy and strategy, that is for an organization of academic nature or a business organization where you have to formulate an IP policy and a long-term vision or strategy for development of IP and also for the encashment or the value extraction of IP. So we will be interested in knowing about business development, conventional and current practices, how business development can be enriched, enhanced by using IP. And we are also going to see something about the innovation aspects of creating IP, how to innovate and create IP. Innovations only lead to intellectual property, and also the need for IP protection, because any amount of IP generated will be wasted if they are not protected properly and they are not put to use or used for the betterment of the business in your hand. So this has to be dealt in detail. Need for IP protection, creation and protection of IP is also discussed. And we will see the various forms of, values of intellectual property and how to extract values out of the created and protected intellectual property in your organization or any organization of small and large large sizes. India and intellectual property will be a brief introduction to what India is doing and how we stand in this intellectual property area, the global arena compared to all the other countries. And also we will briefly discuss about what can be done to better the India's rating or India's standing in the intellectual property area in the global scene. Next is about introduction to IPR. So these are some of the definitions which are often repeated, and you have been hearing it in a number of forums, and also it is well known to most of you, but I will just cover them briefly for the sake of continuity and bringing everybody on a common platform. So what is intellectual property? It is a right awarded by society. Initially, it started with society and the government takes over. That is, government is assuring you protection from your intellectual property for taking action against the people who are using your intellectual property against your permission. Or what is intellectual property? The definition itself is very simple. Intangible creations of human intellect. That is a short and precise definition of intellectual property. Intangible. It is intangible because it is not like a physical cash or property. It is actually intangible in the sense that it is also expressed on paper, but it is having a value for the business which cannot be seen unless it is converted to some form of cash. It has got potential to be converted in the form of cash or property. In other words, it is available, but how to make use of it is in your hands. What are the creations? Generally, the creations are of this nature: inventions. Inventions are leading to patents. Literary and artistic works, they are leading to copyrights and copyright protection. Symbols, names, and images, they are leading to trademarks and trademark protection. And also designs, leading to design of patents, protected by design of patents. And they are all used in business and commerce. Any amount of intellectual property is of no value, no use, unless you're going to use them in business and commerce. And the rights are such that the creator or the owner of the intellectual property, he or she has the right to prevent others from making use of his or her intellectual property without the authority of the owner. That is, unauthorized use will not be tolerated or will not be allowed. And for that matter, the governments are helping all of us, or governments are helping the owners to enforce their rights, and they can intervene and get the compensation from a third party which is not using with the permission of the owner. So the property is actually valid, or the rights are valid for a limited period, number of years is limited for each category of intellectual property. We'll see them in detail later. IP is categorized as industrial property, and author's rights are artistic and literary property. That is for mostly applicable to individuals, and industrial property is applicable to big institutions, organizations, and factories, businesses, manufacturing units, and other small, medium sector organizations. So in a nutshell, there are 4 points to be remembered when you talk about intellectual property. They are creations of mind, that is intellect. And they are giving you exclusive rights, which are excluding others from using the property without your permission or without your sanction. And they are also territorial in nature, because each intellectual property will be confined to that particular country, and within the boundaries of the country, it can be enforced. The rights are also applicable within the boundaries of a country. And so the government of that particular country plays an important role in defining the rights and enforcing the rights, and also in getting the compensation from the third parties which are using without the permission, for getting the compensation from the third parties and giving the due to the owners of this intellectual properties. So there are time-bound rights, which are, some of them are indefinite period of time, some of them are time-bound, like patents. We can have the rights only for the first 20 years of filing the patent. From the date of filing of the patent, we get a time-bound right of up to 20 years. And we will go through some of the different categories of IP, which will be interesting to know, because we are most of the time thinking that it is only patents, patents, and patents. We don't have much idea about all the other forms of intellectual property or the types of intellectual property. They are also equally generating value, and they are also equally valuable to businesses. If you know and understand what are the other types of intellectual properties? For example, we'll start with patents. Patents are in the form of printed documents to start with. They are all, each country's own database is there. For Indian patent office will have its own database of patents, and USPTO, US Patent and Trademarks Office will have its own database of patents, which are actually in the form of applications and also grants. What is the difference there? For every invention, you write an application and submit it to the patent office, and they will publish it as it is without getting examined or granted. Unless you ask for a grant, it will be simply published and left as such. You have to ask for an examination by applying it in a special form and also by paying some fees. The fees varies from country to country. And in India, it's about 8,000 rupees for, for examination, it is a bigger amount of 20,000 rupees for big entities and 5,000 rupees for individuals. So we have to apply in proper forms and pay the fees for getting the applications examined. Then after examination, one more granted patent will be printed, published by the patent office. And all these things are available nowadays in the form of databases, software copies are available. One can search through these patent applications or patent granted, patents granted, and we can get some knowledge about what are the patents which are already in existence in Indian scene, that is within the country as such. So same way, every patent office provides databases for search and extraction of patent documents. If you want to extract them, they are all free services. European Patent Office, US Patent Office, and also World Intellectual Property Patent Offices, they are all providing this type of search and retrieval of patents. And secondly, this printed form will have certain constituents or certain parts of the patent document which are very useful to understand. It starts with an abstract and an image. Then there will be a section called field of the invention, background of the invention, summary of the invention, description, detailed description of the invention, and then it finally ends up in the claims. Claims are having a standard set of claims are written, which are defining the boundary of the invention, which are going to be useful in arguments and court cases when you want to enforce your patent on the people who are using them to prove that they are violating the claims and they are infringing on your claims so that you can get compensation from the third parties. So we will again go through them in order in more details. Trademarks, everybody, each one of you may be familiar with, and you come across in your day-to-day life a lot of these familiar trademarks you see on a day-to-day basis. Trademarks are nothing but symbols, letters, fonts, color combination, and taglines, which are something like "just do it" for Nike, some taglines which are defining the product or the quality of the product. And these are all registered in trademarks office, which are generally co-located with patent offices. And they're also offering a protection of 10 years at a time. And also they will be renewed indefinitely till you are in business or you are interested in renewing them. So you will keep on renewing as long as you require it. Renewal is done for a fee. And another thing about patents, I wanted to tell you that it is also renewable every year. And as you grow in a number of years, that is when the patents become 10 years old or 15 years old, you end up paying more and more money. It is exponentially increasing. And so at the end of the patent life, that is about 20 years later, you would have ended up paying roughly about 4 lakhs in Indian Patent Office for maintaining the patent for 20 years. And then we will go to the next type of intellectual property or category of intellectual property, which is called industrial designs. Industrial designs are also protected by design patents, wherein you just draw the figure of the design, or you may even attach photographs, colorful drawings, and the appearance or aesthetic appearance of the product will be protected. Only the appearance, and there is no technical stuff involved in this. You are only going to present the drawings of number of your products one at a time, and also it will be categorized in terms of some groups. For example, all the chairs will be in one group, and all the porcelain cups and saucers will be in another group. Like that, some categories are there within the designs category, and they will be protected as such, and nobody can copy it because they are protected by the government, and also it is your creation. Number four is trade secret. Trade secrets are very well known, and it is also trade secret means certain things which you don't have to reveal. For example, formula of Coca-Cola. Coca-Cola is a well-known trade secret or unknown secret as such, and they are protecting it within the company, with the top few people in that company will protect it. And once it is leaked outside, then the entire business can collapse. So trade secrets are also important to keep within the company, and within the few individuals of the company will protect them greatly, you know, protected in terms of not letting it out or discussing with other employees, or even the other employees may not know about it. And all these things are also protected, but trade secrets are protected in the form of some other laws and acts. They are not actually protected as a trade secret act, but they are protected as a breach of trust or unbecoming conduct, and such type of criminal procedures can be initiated against the people who are breaching or violating the trade secrets. Then we come to copyrights. Copyrights, definition wise, it is an expression of an idea. Expression in the form of arts, arts, sculptures, drawings, paintings, and also in the form of books. So everybody knows that a number of expressions can be possible for the same song. For example, suppose you take a song of some well-known slogan of, let us say, Bhagavad Gita, and somebody is reciting it in a particular way, and somebody else is reciting in a different way using a different raga. So each one is an expression of the original idea which is in Bhagavad Gita, but each one of them, because of their original rendering, can get protection under the copyrights law. Copyrights law is actually protected by means of registering for copyrights in that copyright office, which is in New Delhi. There's only one copyrights office in New Delhi, but they are also looking for originality and not repetition. It is not copied from somebody. Means they have, for example, if a music is going to be copyrighted, the music should not be copied from somebody else's original work, or it should not be resembling or passing off as another person's work, which is just simply slight variation is there and then copied, and it is also claimed as a ownership for a particular person who is not really a owner of that particular music piece. So they will not be registered. But at the same time, you can keep it yourself and need not register it, but it should be known to everybody. For example, in the form of books, if you see the third or fourth page of the book, you will find the copyright notice will be given with a C circled with a circle C around the C. There is a circle, and which says that copyright issues will be copyright violations will be dealt with in some form of punishment. So please don't copy this. So a warning will be given. Copyright year will be mentioned there, and copyrights are protected as such without being registered anywhere in copyright office. But at the same time, we all we advise the clients or people who are interested in maintaining their copyrights to register it in the copyrights office, which is a much better, safer, and more efficient way of maintaining copyrights. Then there are other forms of intellectual properties called domain names, which we are all aware of. Domain names nowadays are taking much more importance because of online trading and online business deals. For example, Amazon.com or Flipkart or all those names, which are exclusive names and which are to be registered in some third party. And then that third party will register it with the level of World Intellectual Property Office or some such authorities which are maintaining these registers, and duplication and overlapping or copying will not be allowed in domain names. If you want to register your company's domain name, you have to search for it and then see. There are some people who are typically known as cyber squatters, who are trying to register some familiar names and then try to squat on them so that they can get some money out of them. So for a company to start with, while starting up, or a company which is already famous and who are already well known in the public domain, they have to register domain names with little bit of variations, like even spelling mistakes or even with some prefix and suffix, so that somebody else should not take advantage of such things, and then they will start a spelling the company, that company or domain name with a spelling mistake, and then they can pass off as this company for people who are ignorant. Those who are not seriously watching, they may get cheated and your company name will be spoiled in the long run, or then your products and goods will lose importance because of poor and spurious quality goods coming and competing with you in the marketplace. And there are geographical indications, which we've seen yesterday also, and today we will see in brief here. That is about the indication or the tag given to a product or agricultural products of agricultural nature or naturally occurring products, like stones, for Kadapa stones, for example, or manufactured in cottage industries or in big industries. For example, cheese manufactured in some regions of France and Netherlands, they are all getting some label of the region, so that they are exclusively selling them as a special product which is available only in that region, or generated or originated from that region. So region is something like Darjeeling region tea is very famous all over the world. So this symbol is given to all the tea growers who are located in Darjeeling and surrounding areas, not for others who are in other regions of India. So it is also territorial rights and also regional rights. For example, people who are in faraway places cannot make their own tea and then put a symbol of Darjeeling, because that is only applicable to those who are growing tea in the surrounding areas of Darjeeling. So then these type of protections are also given by government of India or government of any other country, where you have to go with an application and then give them a request that these are the things we are protecting and these are the specialities of these goods we are generating from this region, and special taste or some quality is there in those products which cannot be duplicated or which cannot be brought in by other regions. So that will be given as a special privilege or special consideration for putting that name on the product and selling it. Along with your trademark and other company name, this will be an additional tag which is going to be applied on the product. So typically in an organization, either it is big or small, we have to start with IP strategy and roadmap. They have to be defined and formed. So what is your IP strategy? Whether you are going to be protective of your IP and not going to be offensive about your IP. All these strategies can be initially thought of. We are going to protect all our IP, or we are going to simply license in and do some products and services which are subsidiary of another company, and we are going to take license from that company for generating or manufacturing similar projects, products or services, and then sell them in the market. In that case, you'll be paying royalty or the licensing fee to the other company which is owning all those patent rights or any other rights like trademarks and other other categories. So you have to see which are the areas we are strong and which are the areas we are requiring support from other companies in terms of IP ownership. That means we can own certain IP, or we can create our own IP and then own them. And also we will not avoid anybody else to infringe our IP or come into our area of technologies and operations. Then some of the areas which we don't have sufficient R&D or we don't have enough strength in that technology area, we can import technology by means of licensing in the other company's patents, and we will use them for a fee. So like this, you have to formulate the strategy for any company, big or small. Generally, what happens in startups, we start with some amount of ingenuity and some amount of original ideas and original equipment in terms of technologies. So you have to start with protecting the technologies which you are developing and which you are going to protect it, so that anybody else should not use it without your permission. At the same time, this technology may be already in use and already somebody is owning it as an IP or as in the form of patents. Then you have to also be careful, because ignorance is not an excuse. Ignorance of law excuses nobody. So you have to know whether this has been already owned by somebody in the form of patents or not, or you are violating somebody else's trademarks or not. These things have to be checked in the beginning by doing a lot of research, either on the internet or through some specialist organizations which are involved in such activities for a fee. They will do it for a fee. A third party can search and ascertain that your technology is not copied, because you have to be careful that you inadvertently, without your knowledge, you may be using the others' patents or others' technology areas when you are having a startup or when you are starting a new project or product. And it is always better to ascertain that you are not stepping onto the others' territory. So that is one aspect. And if you are not, if you are sure that we are going to develop our own technology and our own R&D, then the funding and scouting activity starts. This activity will have either starting your own R&D and tasking them with the requirements of your technology areas, or like I mentioned just now about getting others' IP or intellectual property in weaker areas of your company and trying to license in some of the patents or license in some of the trademarks, and you want to manufacture under their license, that can be done. So that is called scouting. Then slowly and steadily, you have to build up a portfolio. Portfolio in patent sense is actually a group of patents which are built up around a particular product and the product's features or product's functionalities. We have to build up one patent for each feature, one patent for each functionality, and then we have to build up a bunch of patents surrounding that particular product. At the same time, a product will be named differently. For example, if you are having a particular type of iron box, that will be named as Himalaya, but your company name is something and your product name is something else. So even the product names have to be registered as trademarks. So that also is called a set of trademarks which are going to be built up in the form of a portfolio of trademarks. then the portfolio management starts. Management of portfolio in the sense that you have to keep on revising the portfolio every year or every 10 years in the case of trademarks, every year in the case of patent holdings. We have to see whether this portfolio is really useful to keep or can we discard some of them, because each one is costing money for maintenance. So every year you have to renew the patent. So is it worth renewing it, or is it already a dead investment? Suppose the product is not in the market, or the technology has changed and technology is totally changed and we don't have to maintain this patent anymore, then we lose the patent or simply don't pay the maintenance fee so that it dies its own natural death. Then it comes to the level of commercialization. When you are going to expand the business or you want to grow the business, then you look for people who can use your patents and your trademarks, and they can manufacture and give a cut or profit can be shared from the other companies. You don't have the access. For example, in other countries, if you want to start, you can identify some people who are interested in investing money in this particular product and then give them commercial rights, like licensing out your patents or allowing them to use your trademark and brand name. Then they can manufacture and sell within their country or even within the regions, other regions of India, where you are not able to reach or control. You simply license out your technologies and license out your trademarks, and you can get a fixed amount of money once in the beginning or every year, or in the form of share of profits depending upon the sales of that product in that region. So all these things are continuously being monitored, circulated. It is having a positive effect. If you keep on growing the company, this money will be again pumped into R&D. Then again, funding will take place. Again, growth of portfolio in IP and growth of portfolio in IP will lead to some of the weeding out some of the unwanted patents or unwanted trademarks, portfolio management leading to commercial. This is a good continuous cycle of growth, and it will keep on growing as the company grows in size and revenue. In the earlier cases of business development, people were happy about the R&D and other investments, like in infrastructure, capital investment. Everything costs money, and you may have taken some loans and loans and your own funding. You will generate the products, you are manufacturing the products, and then also in the form of IPR, you are generating some amount of patents, trademarks, copyrights, and all those related industrial products in IP field. Then you're sending the products to market, and then with the help of your established marketing channel, and also this establishment of trademark as a brand in the market, you're able to sell the products in the market, and then you get an income and profit, and everybody was happy with this type of model in the olden days. This is called old and conventional model of business development. So keep on sending back the money from the income and profit. We turn back some money and return it on investment, because investments will be required in the form of replacement of machinery, increase in salaries to the employees, increments, and also new factories or new additional setups you are going to make. So all these things are taken and return on investment. This is going on fine for a long time. Then comes your new and emerging model, which is actually bringing additional revenues or bringing additional income in the form of IPR licensing. Once you have IPR in hand, there will be a lot of interested parties who are going to gain out of your technology, and they don't have to do the R&D again. Whatever R&D you have done, they are going to pay a small fee for licensing of your patent, licensing in, that is called. They can license in your patents and take all these even names like trademarks and your brand names. they can use it, and then they can give a fixed amount of money to you every year, or they can give a percentage share in their profit, because they are also able to sell in the market with your reputation and your brand value. So they can get an IPR license from you in the form of patent licenses or trademark licenses, and then they can add to your revenue. At the same time, there are some know-how licensing or technical know-how which are required for establishing their own manufacturing units. For example, if they have money and they don't know how to start a company, I mean, how to start a manufacturing unit or a factory, then it's not only sufficient if they take your patents and they can, they will not be able to establish the complete manufacturing setup or end-to-end product development, product manufacturing facility on their own. There are a number of hidden knowledge or hidden information which are known to only you and your staff members. That is, your employees only can establish a factory because they have already got experience in the form of implementing certain technologies and establishing the production line. All this knowledge lies with your employees. So you may send your employees and get the factory started working. Erection and operations of new factories will require a lot of knowledge which are not available with the people who are investing money in that. So that is called know-how licensing. For that also you may get some license. This is fairly in the form of you can say trade secrets, or which is known only within your organization, which are certain things which will be done efficiently without wasting resources while installing a factory or commissioning a factory. All this knowledge lies within you and your company employees. They will be given for a fee, and then they will go and establish the factories, and this is in way of additional income we can collect, and that will also lead to income and profit. So now we will talk about an ecosystem which is required for IP generation. And after IP generation, naturally you will follow the sequence of protection, value generation, or commercialization. That is in that order we will see. But first and foremost thing is to have a system in place for IP generation. What are the different aspects of IP generation? Why we should have these things ready in your organization or in your institute or in your establishment? It's a medium, small scale industry or a startup, anywhere. You have to have a well-defined process. And there are some challenges which are day-to-day challenges, which are long-term challenges, which are having an idea at the moment, and they have to shape up in the form of a product at a later stage. So these are the challenges which are always available. Always you are facing a number of challenges when you are starting your own, or when you are facing a number of competitors in a big company. The big companies, they always want to maintain their number one or number two position in that particular product space. So another competitor coming up and growing beyond certain level or taking away the market share is a challenge for a big multinational company also. So these are the challenges which are thrown to the employees. They are thrown open to employees and R&D scientists, and they are told to work for it. They are told to work to meet the challenges or overcome these challenges, how to maintain our lead and steady position in the market space and product space. That is very important. For that, we require organization which is interacting or cooperating with each other without any boundaries. That is, boundaryless organizations where you can take knowledge from one department to another department, and they can cross, there will be a cross-pollination of ideas, and they can borrow ideas from, let's say, mechanical department to electrical department, electrical to electronics, and things like that. So there can be a good cooperation within, and all these things are important for a favorable ecosystem. per IP generation. And they are able to communicate effectively, not only within the organization, but outside the organization also. For example, marketing persons and spokesmen, they are able to effectively and forcefully talk to the media, public people, and advertisement. Through the advertisement, they are able to effectively communicate your value of the products, etc. Then also there will be a position of, you know, rewards and recognition in place within the organization for people who are contributing well for the products, and those who are meeting the challenges, and those who are helping the company to overcome these challenges, they will be rewarded and recognized in a public forum. Public means within the company, all the employees will be knowing about it. Sometimes even it is advertised on papers, and also in town meetings, as they call them, in some of the companies in European region. So town meetings, which are involving all the employees, that is something like general body meetings, where you bring the employee on stage and give a reward or read out a recognition letter, etc. So these are very important for generation of IP. IP generation doesn't start on its own. We will see a little bit later. IP generation starts with some innovation. First, innovations are generated. Innovations are leading to IP. So this is also resembling the same, the earlier circle of IP generation, IP protection, IP valuation. It is also presented in the form of cooperation within an organization, because just now we have talked about the organization and its ecosystem, and an ecosystem should result in this type of interactions, and also the overlapping regions from different departments or groups of people, like R&D groups, business groups, IP groups. They will have something in common. They will all sit together and discuss and finalize certain decisions, and then they will also work forward in teams and joint teams for solving the problems or facing the challenges faced by the organization. So they will be discussing about strategy, converting them into operational plans, and operational plans have to be executed. This is another circle of rotation which is taking place with the positive feedback. It is growing and growing in nature. When as the time progresses, it keeps on growing, and more overlapping takes place. If not 100% overlap on all these three circles, at least major portion should be a overlap in these three departments to start with. I mean, I'm just showing an example of three departments. There can be many more departments, and there can be some disjoint departments which are not brought in here. For example, we are not showing the accounting and finance department, but they are also very important in the case of small scale or medium scale industries, where every decision has to be taken with the consultation of finance department, because after all, a small company cannot afford to spend money, too much of money on R&D, and they will have some limitations. All these things will come only when people get together and put their heads together to arrive at certain useful decisions, and which the decisions they carry forward and execute in the form of products and services, and also they formulate the strategy. So they keep going, undergoing this type of refinement. They keep happening in the form of continuous circle. Now we are slightly shifting gears to see how IP can be generated and what strategy we can follow in an organization for generating IP. So we have innovation to create IP. It's all well known that everybody, it's a buzzword, innovation. All the CEOs say, be innovative, innovate, innovate, and continuous innovate, so that they can bring in some unique products and services on the table and to the public. Then these products and services will result in big revenues, and big revenues will fuel back into R&D and employee salaries increments and more number of employees can be employed and more number of bonuses and their welfare schemes can be floated. All these things are possible when you keep on innovating and be on the cutting edge of technologies and you have one up than the other products and services which are available of similar nature in the market. So we keep on encouraging employees to be innovative. And simply by saying innovative doesn't mean anything. Then they have to be given some directions. We want, for example, if we had been using only an iron box with electrical coils in that, we are not innovating. So some people came up with an idea that we'll have a steam iron box. And then we will, that is an innovation. Then there will be some R&D issues in that. The R&D will be tasked. Then there will be a new business starting with steam irons, let us say. Then we have to have a business plan. We have to have a strategy. And then we will also be thinking about IP and IP plans. Whether this IP is available with us? No, it is not available. Then how much of it can be locally manufactured or generated in the form of our own R&D? Or if it is already established with some big companies who are using this type of technology in the market, then can we get license from them and then manufacture? Because that is cutting the R&D time taken for the R&D at the same time, development of various subsystems and procurement of those spare parts and subsystems from vendors and suppliers. All these things can be cut short if you are just going and taking out the license from a bigger company and then start manufacturing within a few months, you can start. Whereas if you are going for procurement and all those vendors, development vendors, selection, all those things will take some years. Then your product will be lagging behind in time in the market and you will not make the breakthrough in the market which you want to make. So these type of things have to be discussed in detail with employees in the form of regular meetings and updates and throwing challenges to them and saying that what you can do and what you cannot do, and know your strengths, know your weaknesses. And wherever your strengths are there, you develop IP and keep them under your command. Then you can keep it as your exclusive right. Also, sometimes you don't license it out and you keep a dominant position in the market because this is the only technology available with this only company. Then there will be a lot of sales for that particular product. You don't have to license it out if you are having a strong technology. At the same time, when you are weak in that area, then it's better to always license it out instead of spending money in R&D and reinventing the wheel. That too after a couple of years or 3 years later, if you are reinventing the same thing, it's of no use and you cannot even generate IP on it because it is not novel anymore. It is not a novelty. So you know your strengths, know your weaknesses, and inform your employees, keep them updated with knowledge, keep them send them for courses, technical courses outside the organization wherever they are available. Technology develop, technology transfers can also be possible, and they can be valuable contributors if their knowledge is upgraded and their skill sets are upgraded continuously. So we start with research and development. What is research? Research is nothing but methodical investigation into a subject. So this need not be straight away developing into a product. It can be a subject which is science, technology, which is pure science. For example, methodical investigation subject can be even astrophysics, astrology, astronomy, all those things. So we don't have any idea what will happen after doing some studies in that subject. So people will think that it is only seeking new knowledge. So when I went to an astronomy center in Ooty, they were researching about planets and stars, which are some light years away from our Earth. And they are researching them by collecting signals through a radio telescope. So naturally, for the curiosity's sake, I asked, what is the use of all this knowledge? And they simply answered that it is for a new knowledge. We are seeking knowledge. That's all. We don't know how this knowledge is going to be applied and why this knowledge should be applied at all. See, everything need not be generated into a product or service, or it need not be sold in the marketplace to raise revenue. So this type of new knowledge can be useful for generations to come, which may or may not lead you to some new products or services at the later stage. When you are seeking knowledge in that subject, we don't know what is the use of that knowledge. This is something like research in pure sciences or research in pure mathematics. We don't know how it is going to be applied. That is where the research areas are now concentrated. Now, most of the research is concentrated in academic institutions in seeking new knowledge. So they don't know what is going to happen later. But if you are converting the knowledge, which is called the applied sciences or applied technologies, so those things will result in some processes, plants, mission, and there the goal is well defined. This is where the difference between sciences and engineering comes in. The difference between science and engineering comes in because engineering is about systems, processes, plants, mission, and for the sake of society, benefits of these sciences and technology should be converted to useful products and services to the society and common people. That is where the engineering is working. And that is also going to generate some products, processes, business models, and they will result in some utilization. For example, if you are using a vehicle which is running in petrol now, the people are now trying to make some electrical vehicles which are going to be good for environment. They will be having less carbon footprint and they will be less polluting the atmosphere, and then they will also result in savings for the public. Common public who are going to use it, they will spend less money on charging the batteries, and recurring costs will be less. All those things are always thought of. There you have to put in some innovation, and some inventions will take place in that direction to reduce the problems of people and give them facilities, more utilization of resources, better ecological balance, and keeping the environment safe. All those things in these areas, we will be now concentrating research and development, which will result in innovations and inventions. So what is creativity is very important. Only innovation cannot come on its own. It has to come from creativity. And the creativity is inbuilt in some cases. And most of the cases, in fact, it is inbuilt. And in some percentage of cases, it can be kindled or generated with some triggers. It can be encouraged or it can be brought out. So there are two types of creativity. Original creativity, for example, this artistic nature of people will be inbuilt. You can't simply copy it, or everybody by training cannot become a good singer. So it has to be some built-in quality should be there, or inborn quality should be there. That's what they say, God's gift or something. And that can be made to shine or sharpened by having some good training and good environment in which they are brought up. So this type of creativity should be nurtured, increased in volume, and it has to be brought out from the individuals for getting more innovative products or more innovations to be brought on the table. So for bringing innovation, how to make them work for innovation, that is by implementation, new ideas and solutions. That means you give them opportunity to express themselves in the form of new ideas and solutions, so that they can bring out products, processes or services in the form of new and inventive in nature, in the form of products which are new and inventive. They can be taken and patented or made into other forms of intellectual property. It's not necessary that innovation means only products or which are leading only to patents or trademarks, etc. Innovation can be from the time of starting a project till ending a project, which are in the stages. For example, procuring certain spare parts or vendors, suppliers, and other subsystems. All these things also can be done in an innovative way. They can cut the time taken. They can develop some product with the help of vendors also. They need not develop everything by themselves. They can describe the product and explain the product to some supplier, and then they may be good in collecting their own raw materials and supplies, and then making the product and bringing it to you as a subsystem. Those things are also those are the areas in which innovation can be applied. Innovation can be applied in marketing. Innovation can be applied in spending money. Innovation is in every stage of product development. Innovation is in marketing. Innovation can be in selling goods. Innovation can be in advertisement. So every incremental quality which is differentiating you from the other company is innovation. For example, packaging shampoo in the form of sachets, which are affordable to all the people with low income. They can sell the sachets for 1 rupee each in the form of small packets. So they are all innovative way of addressing the market and selling the goods in the market. They are not going to be patented in the sense that these are not patentable, but they are innovative. There are a number of innovations which need not lead to IP. So innovation is a very big, large bowl of ideas, out of which only a subsection or a subset of ideas can be leading to your IP conversion. Converting innovation to IP is in a very small percentage. That's what I wanted to show you. So innovation can continue in hundreds and thousands of ways, but IP generation need not be there, or it is not possible also in all the innovations you are going to apply on your business decisions. How are you going to foster the innovation? Fostering innovation means encouraging employees to bring up new ideas and thoughts, innovative ideas, innovative procedures, processes, innovative ways of thinking, establishing some product lines, pipelines, and you are going to establish a position in the market, and also giving some additional facilities, features in the form of, solving some problems for people. For example, earlier we didn't have maps in the cell phones. Somebody came with an innovative idea of providing maps and also the routes in the cell phone. So that is an innovative idea, which may lead to patents and related technological development. But there are a number of innovative ideas which are solving problems and giving solutions without getting into patents or any form of IPs. So for all these innovations, we require employees to be educated properly in terms of customer focus, asking the employees to analyze all the, even the R&D teams are sometimes called to analyze the complaints received from the customers for an established product in the market. The customers are complaining about a particular aspect again and again. That means the repetitive errors, problems with the product, they have to be addressed by R&D to solve that problem in the marketplace. Then there will be a constant competitor watch. You have to keep on watching the competitor about their growth and their pattern of growth, their products, new products coming in the market, and what are their future plans, if possible you can get it, and how to combine features and providing, for one example I told you about this map, providing maps on the cell phones and things like that. Then current affairs, for example, if there is a COVID threat, pandemic threat, then all the medical fraternity and all the companies who are in healthcare business, they will be geared up to meet the challenges, and also new products will be, there are a number of products which are not known earlier, for example, masks and PPEs, PPE kits, they are all manufacturing in large numbers. So all the companies who are doing some other manufacturing will turn their attention into this type of products which are the need of the hour or the requirements suddenly coming up in the market. These things are all known because they are closely watching the current affairs and what is happening in the world or what is happening around us. So this is one side is the input and the other side is the reaction. This left side we have, all these things have to be collected and given to employees. On the right side, we have to proportionately work in terms of brainstorming for ideas. People put in a room and then told to brainstorm. Think about it loudly and keep providing some solutions, even though it is silly. It may appear silly, but it may actually materialize when you put two and two together and then make the system working. So you eliminate the possibilities which are not working, and people will talk against each other, or it is not a personal vendetta or personal fight, but they will shoot down the ideas and they will find faults with the other's ideas or pick some holes in their arguments and then say why it will fail, or everything is theoretically discussed before getting into a practice or getting into an R&D kind of project. Then we encourage employees to think laterally. After all these things, we launch a product, a project. Then the project will go through some modifications as and when you keep on facing some difficulties or problems, or when you get newer ideas, and then you can modify the product or project to add some more new features and also to add some facilities to make it more powerful, strong, and make it more foolproof, and it will be having a good reception in the marketplace. So for all these things, you keep on watching all these things and then say these are the things you want to employ in your organization for making the employees work together in the form of closed teamwork, and these things will come out as a number of innovations. And this is a very popular innovation funnel. You must have already heard in some other forums also of innovation converted to products and ideas. And in the context of intellectual property, this is also important because you are not going to take all the innovations. That's what I was telling just now, that there may be hundreds of innovations, but you have to reduce them into a final stage at the rate of something like 0.1% or 0.01% of the total number of ideas floated. They only will result in some useful products. One or two products are going to be launched at the end, but we have to go through all this brainstorming, shooting down the ideas, and then selecting some ideas which will be current and also useful for the present situation, and how much research funding you can spare. All these things result in some amount of filtering at every stage. And then it is also called the funnel of innovation, where you start reducing the numbers to finally arrive at one or two products. This is very simple and self-explanatory. We will go to the IP protection now. So here we will talk about IP protection, IP value extraction, and realization of commercial value. And here I want to take a short break of 2 to 3 minutes. If somebody wants to ask some questions, they can ask. I will just be available here only. Or if there are no questions at this stage, I can proceed. But I need a short break of 2 to 3 minutes. Can organizers step in and see whether there are any questions at this stage? Hello? Shall I continue?
Sir, please continue, sir. Sir, please continue, sir.
Okay. So, now we come to the stage of IP protection. Once you have reduce the number of innovations and then decided which direction, decided about the directions in which you have to go for R&D and generating your own IP, then it is important to think about ways and means of protecting your own IP. This protection is very useful on two counts. While protecting your own IP and also knowing about others' IP at this stage, you'll avoid two things. One is risk of infringing others' product, that is infringing others' IP without your knowledge. So you have to do some amount of search and analysis to find whether in this area of this product with these features and which technologies which you are going to employ, are there already IP available with others? If they are not having IP, then we will have our own IP in these areas. This is known as freedom to operate searches. That is, we have to do some searches in the granted patents and see whether there are granted patents in this area, not only granted patents in the area of trademarks, and also resembling the product names should not be there. The same product name is there in some other company, you can't use it, and after releasing the product, you should not come to know, and then that will be stopped from entering the market. That's called injunction. Injunction can be taken by the other company for using their product name. So all these things have to be checked to avoid the risk or mitigate the risk. That is one requirement for IP protection. And also, protecting IP means you are going to get some patents and you are going to register certain trademarks and copyrights. There you will be using them as a valid authority of raising some venture capital funding. Venture capitalists, so-called angel investors and all these people, they don't invest freely and easily without knowing whether you have got your IP protected or not, because they are also risk averse. They don't want risk of their investments. So they want to know whether the IP you have is protected properly or not. So for them, it's good to show that I have already filed so many patents. I have already filed for registration of these trademarks, trade names, taglines, etc. But at the same time, instead of simply applying, if you have a registration certificate or granted certificate of patents, then it is much more valuable and much more strengthening your argument when you are asking for funding. So from the time of registration and grant, there will be some amount of lag, a time delay. So it is always better to start as early as possible when the ideas are still on the drawing board stage and where you are still thinking of launching a company or product. So you have to start registration of IP at that point in time. even though it is not yet taken shape or the product is not yet ready, but you know exactly what is to be done and how the technology is going to be developed by you. There are two things to be done to check whether the technology is already owned, or if it is not already owned, then you go for getting a grant in the form of patents for your technology. Then you can think about generating value for your granted patents or your granted other IP. So generating value is the last stage of this sequence of events or steps taken right from the starting point. Now we have come to a certain stage of, you know, understanding the IP landscape. We know that IP is required for us, and we want to grow in technology areas, and we want to grow in product areas. We have to have acquisition of IP. That is required in most of the big companies. Their own in-house R&D is not able to meet the requirements, or they are not able to meet their challenges. This is true in case of even leading organizations like DRDO and ISRO. They don't do everything in-house R&D. They outsource R&D. That means they will identify some good companies or good leading technical entities which are ready to convert their specifications into subsections, subsystems. So that is what is happening in a number of labs in DRDO as well as in ISRO, where the R&D is outsourced. They will only give the specifications, and to meet the, for example, a communication system has to be developed with a figure of merit so and so, and their sensitivity and all those signal levels and final gain, etc. Everything is in the form of specifications given to a private entity, and the private company will develop the whole thing, and they will demonstrate that this is what we have achieved. Then it is very easy for the organization to go and check the parameters and check the specifications. They are in order. So this is in the form of outsourced R&D. Then the IP will be shared, or it can be owned by the third party or the person who is supplying the subsystems. Either they can fully own it, or they can partially own it with the help of this organization which has given the contract, because this organization is giving the contract and giving the money also. So sometimes they will take exclusive rights of their IP, which is developed even outside the agencies. But most of the cases, they will come to some via media or some intermediate solution in which some understanding will be there for the percentage of IP sharing, etc. Then we also go for open innovation in case of IP acquisition. Open innovation means keep on looking for somebody who can do innovation on their own, but they are ready to sell the innovation to you. This IP scouting is you are openly going and asking for things, and then you are going to pay money in the form of a lease and get the IP. And open innovation can be sometimes fully funded R&D research, and then take all the IP which is generated from that research into your fold, or take over all the IP generated through open innovation. And also these are very common in today's technology companies, where mergers and acquisitions are very common. Suppose you don't have that kind of technology in your organization, then it is better to acquire the company or merge with it. That's what Google, Facebook, and other big leading companies are doing. They will simply buy the other company, which is actually providing a good service to the public, or the large customer base is there in terms of, let us say, WhatsApp is having some millions of users. So you simply take the company along with the IP and merge with your parent company, and then start using their IP also for growing into other areas. And mergers and acquisitions are also one form of bringing in IP into your company's portfolio. And in some cases, it is not fully owned. This need not be always that it need not be that 100% ownership can be there for all the IP which you own, because other companies may not part with their IP. So in that case, you can share the IP or you can lease in. That means you can pay money and lease it out. This is another example of, you know, hundreds of leasing can be done. For example, manufacturing of those CD players used to be there, and manufacturing was done in some 100 different manufacturers. Hundreds of them were manufacturing CD players because suddenly there was a big growth in CD players market, and they were not able to supply from the original manufacturers. So they will lease it out, the technologies, and then some few 100 to 200 patents were required to be used in this manufacturing. So they will form a consortium of a group of people, group of companies who are owning all these patents, and that consortium will lease out all the patents to the new manufacturers who are going to come into this field. And they will be paying certain amount of licensing money to this consortium, and they will be sharing the money among themselves. So that is a kind of lease operations can be done. And then sometimes it is acquired, in the sense that you just go and outright buy some shares. The shares are also like property, sold in auction, sold openly in marketplace, and sold in some academic institutions. They are annual some sales, this one they announce, and then they publish all the patents which are ready for sale, and they fix some flat rates or some negotiable prices they fix, and then they can be acquired by some big companies who are lacking in those areas of technology, or they are not willing to manufacture, they are not willing to fund the R&D and get the patents and technologies in that area. They can simply go to the academic institutions or some other smaller companies who are specialized in that particular technology. They can buy that and acquire the technologies and IP directly by paying money. Then we will have a step back and see what are the patent rights which are conferred by the governments to the patent holders. So the governments are saying that you can have exclusive rights to make, use, exercise, sell, distribute. These are all, each one has got some connotation. Each word is well defined, and also it's covering each segment of the use of this product or the technology. Make, use, exercise, sell, distribute, invented article or process. At the same time, if you are using this patent for R&D in your lab, R&D can be in your lab or in your own garage, backyard, or somewhere. If you want to use these patents for R&D and build your own product, one single product, if you are building a prototype out of this technology and patents, that is allowed. That is not called violation of patent or infringement of the patent. It can be experimented and it can be tried in R&D, but it cannot be mass produced and sold in the market. Then you are liable to be taken to court, and then you are liable to be paying some compensation. You'll be fined for that. So instead of that, you have to take a license and manufacture your own product and sell it. So rights can be shared when the patentees are more than one. That means some joint venture companies are joining together and then developing technologies, or one or more inventors are jointly developing some idea or product. Then that is actually the outcome of patent. That is, whatever revenue brought by the patent can be shared by the owners or the inventors when there are more than one. And it can be licensed or sold for commercial consideration. That has been already known, and we have been talking about it And that is the patent rights are also giving rights to initiate legal proceedings against infringement. Infringement is a word which is a loaded word, which is legally understandable. So it will be covered in another slide later. What is infringement is a big topic, and it can be covered in some brief detail here. Patent owner can commercially exploit the potential of his or her invention without fear of copying or this is obvious because your own technology, your own patent, so you can use it for your own purpose, even if it is for selling goods in the market. So what are these different stages in which you have to check for IP and create IP? So as we have already mentioned, it is very much required at the time of start of a company, even though the company is still in the form of a drawing design, and it is right on the table in the form of drawings. It's not yet taken a shape. Even that time, the IP categories can be identified, ascertained, and they can be applied for grant in different patent offices or different trademark offices all over the world if you want. And there are some facilities of applying at one place and then getting grant in a number of places. That is, for trademark, there is something called Madrid Protocol, through which you can get protection in some 40 to 50 countries at a time by applying it in one trademark office, let's say in India. If you are applying, you'll automatically get protection in multiple number of countries. So like that, you can try various ways and means. So it involves a lot of outlay. Money has to be spent in advance for protecting your IP. It's also true for a company doing a product development, starting a product. At the time of starting a product, you require some technologies which have to be identified, and they have to be checked whether they are all in our possession or they're all already patented by somebody else. Then we have to take patents if it is not there in the patent grants. Already granted patents are not there, then we take patents in that area by applying for patents and also applying for names and symbols and trademarks, copyright materials such as software. All those things have to be protected. People have to be educated. All the employees have to be made aware of what to do and how to do it, when to do it. All those IP related education has to be given, which is very slow and steady progress we can make it in this area. Subsequently, in the midstream or somewhere in the middle of the product, as I know, in some big companies, a product development takes more than 3 to 5 years. At times it takes about 5 years also to roll out a product from the inception or idea stage to the final product stage, which is making the product available in the market can sometimes take 3 to 5 years, at the maximum 5 years. So we have to take a considered opinion at the middle of the product cycle, that is product development stages, and you have to check at that point in time whether any new IP has been added or any new IP has been generated which require some protection. So what during the course of the project, you constantly keep checking in periodic intervals, and at least once in the middle of the project time frame, so that you decide what to do at that point in time about the IP. And also at the end of the project development, when the project is ready to be launched in the market, that time you have to be very careful and 100% clearance check has to be done. Otherwise, you are taking a risk if you are not done clearance or clearances. Clearance means it is by checking whether IP exists for this product, because this duration of 3 to 5 years is long enough for another company or another party to get a patent on this product or in these features of this product. So you have to again ascertain at the end of the product development, just before launching, and see whether it has been already done by somebody or Otherwise, what you face is that your products will be launched and they will appear on the shelves of the shops. Then the company which is owning the technology or the patent can move to court, and then they will take an injunction. And as soon as the product appears in the market, your product will be stopped from appearing on the shelves of the shops. So this is called injunction. They can move to the court, and then they take a court order saying that all these products should be stopped in the market. So that is a big risk, and you should avoid it at all costs. So that is by taking some defensive measures, you are avoiding a big loss. So that's a must for checking just before entering the market. And like all the areas of life, you feel that you have creation, protection, and destruction of IP. We have to create as and when new technologies come, as and when you enter into new technology areas, then you create some new patents, create some new, establish some trademarks, and some trademarks are old, some products are out of the market, some products have vanished because of technological revolution. And for example, if the film cameras have gone and digital cameras have come, then all those patents and trademark names pertaining to that film cameras, they can be removed, and then only the new digital cameras will appear and new technologies will be developed according to the requirements of the market we are going to change. So in that case, we have to voluntarily stop some of the patents getting renewed in that direction. So those patents need not be renewed, and they can be allowed to die or cease to live. And then protection means it is paying renewal fee and then keeping them alive. So you keep on checking every year for protection and which are the things to be renewed. There are some companies who are just letting the patents go from their hands. Hundreds of patents will be just discarded every year for the sake of, you know, the paying fee, or to avoid paying fees, which are a big major saving, which can result in a big major saving. So you want to avoid payment of maintenance fee for useless patents, or patents which are of no use to anybody for that matter. To keep them renewed is expensive. So, well, different types of value generation or income generation. Royalty income is one. And there is another thing called, this is where the aspect of, you know, notional income, or the value is actually estimated or guessed, in the sense that royalty savings, how much royalty you would have paid via cross licensing. That means how much royalty. There are two ways of paying royalty to other companies. One is licensing in of their patents. In that case, you are going to pay money. That is possible. That can be avoided if you have your own patents. And also, if you have certain number of patents and company X and company Y, they have some equal number of patents. Let us say company X has got some 500 patents and company Y has got some 600 patents in the same medical system. For example, a big system like MR system, or in the case of a CT, that is computerized tomography systems. These systems can have hundreds of patents which are required to be applied in this full product, a big product which will require a few hundred patents. And each company will own, let us say, 200 patents in the same product. And without each other's cooperation, the full product cannot be built by each one individually. Therefore, they sit together and do some negotiation, and they agree to cross-license some of the, most of the patents which are owned by them. In the sense that you can take most valuable patents without which the product cannot be developed. And then you take some more patents and then equate them This is actually like an hypothetical case of, you know, taking a patent and then valuing it in terms of money, in terms of, let's say, dollars. So then there's a lot of negotiation going on in this area, and they continuously negotiate and then find out that what is the value conversion in terms of money, and then who is having a bigger amount to be paid and who is having lesser amount to be paid. That cross-licensing will result in some delta T amount, that is incremental amount to be paid to the other company. Or it can sometimes happen that a major amount is to be paid and some amount is saved. So we say, what is the royalty saving? If I had to completely license in the whole thing, then I would have paid some X amount. Then because of my own strength and my own patents, I am paying Y amount. So the difference is X minus Y, that much money I have saved. That is called royalty saving. And in some cases like Apple, exclusive market position is to be obtained. So they don't want to license out their patents to others, and they will sell everything under their brand name only and their own showrooms and their own dealers. And they will maintain an exclusive market position so that they can dominate the market, and their margins are very high. They can increase the margin to any extent, and they can have profit with a very high margin of profit they can have. So to have an exclusive market position, you have a number of patents which are kept within your company, and you don't want to sell or lease out those patents to anybody to maintain a dominant position in the market. That is also possible. That is also kind of value, because you see the result in terms of high margins. Whatever profit margin you keep, people are ready to buy. So you are having a big profit margin, which is not possible otherwise, which you don't have IP or which you don't have technology strength. Then there will be some people who are interested in copying. Then you can even catch them and ask them for compensation. For example, what happened in the case of Apple versus Samsung, wherein the Samsung was asked to pay $1 billion compensation for using Apple's design and other patents. And also, if you are licensing out patents to get value out of them, you can join with other companies as a joint venture, or you can even spin out a company or spin in. That means you become a partnership to another company. And this type of spin-offs can also result in value. These are different types of value generation from patent portfolio. Then there are two ways of licensing procedures. They are called carrot and stick policy, or stick and carrot policy, whatever way you want to call it. These are two separate chains of raising income or bringing revenue out of your patents, especially. That is to find identifying products in the market which may be or may not be infringing your patents. Then you set some people to work for finding the proof or evidence of infringement. Then find the proof, keep solid proof, and then you engage in negotiations with the company. This is typically a stick policy. It is, you know, first they will write a nice sounding letter saying that we came to know that you are using our this thing, so please come for negotiation. Naturally, the other company will refuse and say, we are not copying. Then you will send some lawyer notice, and they will also use some legal terminologies to force them, bring them on the negotiation table. On the negotiation table, you conclude some negotiation and sign some agreements for paying licensing fee every year, a fixed fee, or based on the sales and based on the total revenue collected by the other company, fraction of that, or the profits fraction of a profit can be collected. and maintain that every year the payment can be in the form of you know, every year royalties or every 6 months they can pay, and keep a mechanism in place to keep checking whether they are paying in time. Otherwise you have to again go and talk to them or send them some lawyer notice and get the money. This collection is also equally important and equally tough compared to all this chain of, you know, finding proof and negotiations, because they may sign an agreement or contract and they may not pay. So collection also is very important. For that, people will be involved in continuously monitoring and asking them to pay, threatening them to take to court if they are not paying in time, or if they have to pay with some penalty, they have to pay that money also. All these things are important in a big multinational corporations or even small companies when they are owning patents and they have to get money from big companies. These type of things can happen. And another way is that smooth way of, you know, operating is to identify companies and products which they will be requiring your technologies and your patents. Bring them to the organization or call them in a common place like a big hotel and explain the potential by calling some 15 to 20 manufacturers of these products at the same time. We can do it like a seminar or a symposium and explain the potential of the patents, value of these patents, and negotiate. These products may or may not be right now available, but they may be having plans to develop these products. So you can proactively explain your value of these patents and get them involved in the negotiations and conclude the negotiations and collect money. And then they give them freedom to use their own freedom to manufacture their own products and sell in the market. So both ways it is possible. The finding proof is the toughest part. This is a much easier part. That means it is a smooth way of operating and talking to them without getting into the threatening mode. It is like, you know, marketing and sales. So this is also involving collection problems at the end. This has to be always protected by some means of, you know, regulations or these terms and conditions of the contract and penalty clauses. All those things have to be covered for getting money out of these potential users of your patents. How to find infringement? I will just be back in 5 seconds. Yeah, I'm back. So how to find infringement is the toughest part of the entire chain of events. So what is infringement and how infringement is detected, we will see. Typically, a party which is manufacturing, importing, using, or selling, or offering for sale. These are all different you know, classes in the legal aspects, terminologies which are going to be used. So any one of them, if you are doing without the permission of the patent owner during the term of the patent and within the country that issued the patent, is considered to be an infringing party. So infringement is not so easy to detect. It has got a lot of technical involvement, technical people's involvement. And also at the time of getting a patent or before applying for a patent, we have to see how easy or difficult to find infringement in this product of this patent. Can we find infringement easily or not? Some of the cases I've seen, they can stop at the time of applying for patent if the infringement cannot be detected by whatever means, however you try. suppose infringement cannot be detected, let's say in the form of embedded systems or some of the programs which are not easy to decode, or they will look similar and they can easily be copied. You cannot say it is my own program or it is my original program. For example, if you are using FFT program and somebody else is copying it, you can't say it is my program because it can be copied from so many other sources. Or it is impossible to even find whether the infringement has taken place in some cases, because without, suppose you break the product and then find infringement, then by the time your evidence also is broken. So you can't prove it in the court. Then at the time of applying for patent, you will stop. You need not apply for patent because it is not going to be easy to detect the infringement. So you keep it as a secret only, trade secret or within the company secret. So you don't publicize it in the form of patent. That is one aspect. Second thing is, we give this type of reverse engineering or decoding the machine code. Suppose it is in the form of machine code and then you have to find the algorithm which is developed by you is converted from top level program to machine level program, that is machine code. Then reverse engineering to reach the top level can be done by some agencies. For example, academic institutions like Indian Institute of Science or some such places, you find experts doing such things for a fee. So you have to take the help of such experts and reverse engineer the product's features and then see, show that these features are infringing my claims or my patent's claims. Therefore, we have to seek justice or ask for compensation, stop the product from the market, selling in the market, and all these infringement procedures will follow. So the biggest part is infringement, proving infringement. So for that, we require a product first, product of that particular infringing party. So you, generally what they do, they go to a market or exhibition or somewhere, and then take the features of the product in the form of pamphlets or photographs and other literature, or even the product itself if it is available in the market, buy the product and then show to a specialist or expert who can find proof of infringement. Then you produce both as evidence in the court and ask the infringing party to appear before the court, and they will put up some arguments. And generally what the arguments are, the infringing party will first deny that it is an infringement. Then secondly, they will say if the infringement is proven, then they will say the claims are not valid. What is meant by claims are not valid? That means the patent itself is not valid. Patent itself is not valid because of novelty and inventorship aspect. Then they will try to prove that your patent doesn't have novelty and inventive step, even though you have got it granted through the patent office examination and procedure and other things, got it granted sometime back, say 5-6 years back. And now the opposing party will produce evidence that it was known before the date of filing of the patent in the form of product or in the form of a publication literature that this novel feature is well known before the application was filed 5-6 years ago, let us say. So that is the way the court cases proceed. Then you are in another defensive position of finding yourself whether there is any damaging literature or some evidence which is going to kill your novelty from the before the date of filing of this patent application. Then some corporations, big company, they'll start doing their own search in the previous, date prior to the application, date of application, to find whether any damaging documents are available in the databases. Because there could be so many reasons for not finding it at that point in time. They would have overlooked certain things, or the examiner also had overlooked certain documents and then granted it. But that particular damaging document is unearthed or found by the opposing party, then you are in a defensive position. Then your patent can get the patent can be cancelled. That is, the patent can be invalidated in the court. So all these procedures will take place. So to go for infringement claim, that is, your product or feature is infringing my patent. How do you prove it? It is by saying that the your product or feature of the product is falling within the range of one of my claims or one or more of my claims. Then you have to read the claim and see the product feature and then match them. See whether it is matching. There may be exact, there may not be exact match, but there may be reading on. That means that is a typical legal word saying that it is almost there, but it is not exactly there kind of thing. So reading on can be interpreted in a different way in different places, different courts, different lawyers can interpret it. And then it has to be proven in front of a judge that it is actually infringing the claim and then ask for compensation. So all the claims are found in the product. It is called literal infringement. Then there is no proof or argument required. That has to be, you know, it's obvious that all the features of the product are falling on the claims, and it is also obvious. So we have to ask for infringement claims, that is infringement punishment, infringement compensation. Then we have commercialization models, which are licensing out, sale, trading of shares, JP, that IP mortgaging or loans. IP can be as a property, it can be mortgaged and loans can be raised. And then it is also sold in auctions in some auction houses. There are some regular annual auctions taking place of patents. The companies which are not requiring those patents will come and sell it in those auctions, or startups which are not anymore interested in keeping those patents will sell off their patents, and people interested, those who are bigger companies interested in buying them will buy them. And patent owners can have joint ventures with those who are looking for technology transfer, and also they want to start a new establishment of manufacturing some product, they will come for joint venture. And cross licensing, I've already explained about, you know, value of patents converted into money, and then it is equated, and whatever is excess amount will be paid by the other party. There are venture capital funds which can be raised by having your own IP. And you can have collaboration with partners like suppliers, vendors. They can also become your partners in IP. And we can also start IP deals and ventures in, you know, only dealing in IP. There are so many people called cartels of IP, who are only buying and selling IP and not involved in any of the technology transfer or technology implementation or making product, but they will be only buying and selling IP. So they are getting into IP deals and ventures. So we have, in a nutshell, bringing everything into the same categories of business objectives, how they are meeting the business objectives. So you can keep it exclusive and keep increasing your profit margins, typically what like Apple is doing. And you are dominating the market, and whatever you fix as a price, it will be sold and people will buy it without hesitation because of brand value and also the strength of the technology. And you can use your IP to bring new customers, increase supply to existing customers, and that way you can increase your market shares, and then that product will dominate in the market anywhere you go. That is the only product available, and the other products will be dwarfed, or they will become minority in front of this, and they will be sold less, and you will dominate the market in this fashion also. And you can enter new markets, like new company and new areas of the same country or new countries in the world. You can enter with the help of collaboration and procuring access. Suppose you want to establish some market in some new place like Africa, but other person is not having interest in establishing a manufacturing facility in Africa, then you can go and establish with the help of other person's patents by taking them on lease, provided they have valid patents, granted patents, and live patents in that region. Developing new markets, which have already been discussed. Increasing revenues, we can keep on increasing revenues through reinvesting, and it is in the that, you know, positive feedback which was shown in the first few slides, that it keeps coming back to the R&D and R&D grows. And like I mentioned yesterday also, R&D requires a lot of money to generate IP wealth, create strong patents. Roughly about what one senior high level person said is that $1 million, if you spend on R&D, it will create one patent of value. That means one patent which can bring some revenue. We don't know whether it will bring $1 million itself or it can bring much more than $1 million. But that is the average spending required in R&D for bringing revenue in terms of strong patents. And we discussed yesterday also about this global IP index. I was intrigued and found that why India is in position 36 in the year 2019, in previous year, that is year before, and it has come to 40 in 2020. This is actually negative growth in terms of IP. Global IP index is actually formulated by American chambers, and they are comparing all the leading nations which are strong and weak in this one. And there are about 53 nations, I think 50 plus countries. 50 unique indicators are used and 50 countries are compared in their performance. And finally, they arrive at some ranking or listing in different areas. For example, if the filings and grant of each category is certain number, that is taken into consideration. So that is they are contributing to 10 factors. And remaining factors are varying from the revenue generated, the enforcement discipline, how literate the people are, awareness of courts and lawyers, adequacy of courts and enforcement mechanism, and strength of patent offices, how strong the patent office. So all these things are factors are brought into some form of numerical values, and then they have to be calculated and compared in a big framework of listing. Then in that, India is coming 36. So we are at a crossroads thinking that why we are not able to do well in the why we are not able to contribute to this IP economy. IP economy is economy generated by IP dealings, that is licensing in, licensing out, joint ventures, cross licensing, money savings. All these things contribute to an IP economy, which is actually a global economy. That is in terms of, I don't know, there used to be some measure for this, but right now a search for that, it is in terms of some $100 billion or something like that. So it is not a small amount. So it can be any amount, like 100 to $150 billion rough estimate. It used to be some 25 to 30 billion some 25 years ago. But right now I am trying to search and I could not get a figure for this, but it's a big amount, huge amount, in which all these strong companies which are having strong patents, big multinationals, they are having strong R&D and strong patents, which are collecting royalty from smaller players in the market or from each other. They are all collecting money, and then that is shown as IP economy and IP transactions, money transactions in IP. They are generating a lot of wealth in the entire global scene. Is India really contributing to IP economy is the question which is to be answered, which we can all join together and answer, in the sense that all contribute to this growth of IP economy. And education system is not conducive. That's what everybody from our friends in other countries used to say, that education system in India is only encouraging this rote learning. Rote learning means just mugging up and then going and writing something without understanding the purpose or concept level, and just by blindly mugging up and then writing exams and then passing, getting a degree. That's all our aim is, to get a degree without going in-depth analysis and then understanding. Your education system is not providing solutions to unknown problems. See, you have to solve known problems first. Then with the help of those solutions, we have to solve unknown problems which you are going to face in the world or in the in the company scenario, where this type of challenges can be thrown at you. Are you able to solve these problems by the experience which you had while solving the problems in the educational institutions? The answer is yes or yes and no. Some things which can solve, some things which cannot solve. So we are now emerging as reverse engineering expert. This is what is being done in traditionally from time immemorial. We are doing it in public sector undertakings, or even national laboratories, leading laboratories of DRDO, ISRO, or CSIR. All these places, what we do, buy a product, reverse engineer the product in our lab, and then we claim success to it, and which is not really going to contribute to IP, because it's already somebody's IP, and you are having protection in government labs that they cannot catch government labs for using the other's IP. Government has got permission to use the IP, as long as it is not being used for commercial purpose. Commercial means it is only using as a R&D purposes, and it is not commercialized in large scale, or it is not taking profit out of it. So it cannot be enforced. That is, infringement cannot be proven or enforced. So that is why the reverse engineering was our strong point. We are good in reverse engineering, and it has also conveyed, and it is also resulted in number of companies in the outside also, non-government organizations also, they are good in reverse engineering. That is why our technologies have never grown. At least if we have taken licensing in and manufactured certain products, we could have really jumped the technological gap. But we have been always happy with reverse engineering. Then wherever reverse engineering is not working, or foreign products cannot be copied, we go into a Jugaad mode. Jugaad mode is that we use whatever is domestically within the country, whatever small little pieces available, join together or use one solution into others. For example, using a pressure cooker for an espresso, a coffee steam generator, things like that. So we try to be happy and do this type of things, and we are experts in Jugaad, and it has been noticed by a number of big multinational companies, CEOs, and they also started encouraging and saying that here comes India with a lot of Jugaad invention. So let us all do Jugaad. That was a buzzword some time ago. But it is not going to serve any purpose. It cannot be patented, or it cannot be converted into IP. And also we always go for cheap solutions. Cheap solution means if you find in our project work, every time everybody says low-cost system. Low-cost system is an excuse or apology. Why do we apologize saying that it is a low-cost system? Agreed that India is a poor country and it cannot afford to pay for their products at a high level. That doesn't mean we will generate low-cost systems with poor quality inputs, poor quality subsystems, and all of them will lack in reliability in the field, and they will all fail. That is why you go through rigorous testing. For example, if it is requiring some military level use or aircraft use, they have to go through a lot of environmental testing, and also some reliability tests like robust material testing and breakdown operations and all that. there the things will fail if you are going for low cost systems. So low cost is a kind of, you know, apology and some kind of excuse that should not be there. And in IT industry, we are employing big numbers in 10 lakhs, 15 lakhs. People say some 25 lakhs is the upper limit in IT industry. But you see the dismal performance of these IT industries in terms of getting R&D and then getting IP. IP means number of patents. If you see, you can count in, it will be less than 10, less than 15 like that, even though their turnover is in billions of dollars, their investment in R&D is very small. They are not investing like big companies, which are technology companies. They are happy with the services being done at IT industry. Even then, we are still at the rate of some 3 to 4% of the total turnover of IT industries. IT means the software industry's global turnover is 100%, out of which our share of contribution or our share of turnover is only 3 to 4%. Maybe it is even less, I'm not sure, but it is one estimate says that we have got 97% left to other countries. So still we are touting this as a success story, and we are, of course, it is employing a lot of people, that is to be seen as a positive point, positive aspect. But it all starts with IP awareness. So I put it in the end, but it should be the first point. IP awareness is very poor, even among qualified people, like even though they have reached some postgraduate and research master's PhDs levels. What is possible in IP, what is not possible in IP, against this IP rules and regulations, can this be done or not? It is not known. It is not well known to people who are highly qualified in academic institutions or even in big companies. So that IP awareness has to start from a very early age, or very early stage of, you know, schools and primary schools, even kindergarten schools, I would say it should start. Because that is the time they should be aware of copying each other's answer books. See, copying each other's answer book is also an IP violation. Intellectual property is being taken away free by somebody else. You must have done very hard work and you have a good brain to retain things. But somebody with zero knowledge and zero retention capacity can copy your things and answer books and pass, or maybe may get high marks also. So from there, it should start, that IP protection and IP awareness. So we have already covered this in detail. So I want to summarize the whole thing saying the following things. R&D cannot stand on its own. It is not like, you know, pumping in money in R&D and looking for results immediately. It has to be a small scale R&D starting and producing some creative quality goods and services. And then by generating revenue, a part of revenue is fed back into R&D. In many cases, it so happens that R&D starts with a bang, and then after the products are successful, the R&D supply is cut and R&D funding is cut, then R&D will die its own death and they are satisfied with whatever product they have produced. So to maintain the lead in the market and maintain number one position in the market, constant R&D and expansion of R&D is very much required. Otherwise, you cannot maintain a lead in the business. Innovations must be generated. There is no excuse for not generating inventions. We are all having creative minds. Only fostering invention and bringing out the best in the minds, it is not being done by the education system as well as from the company side, inventive, that is incentive systems, and also funding for R&D. All these things are lacking, which encourages innovations leading to IP generations. And that is why we are not being innovative or inventive. Our number of patents filed is pitifully low, about 50,000 compared to 1.5 million in countries like US, and also 1.5 million in China and somewhere around 1 million, sorry, 0.5 million in US and other countries like Japan. We are at least this much is also grown from a very low level, and then it is a steady growth. But what is required is a sudden or tremendous amount of growth is required. So for that, we have all to contribute, and we have to take responsibility and do something for creativity, innovation, and generation of IP. After generation of IP, we have to get involved in protection of IP, and there comes the value generation or commercialization of IP. So this many steps or stages are required for actually generating value out of IP and growing your business. So we are at this crossroads for a good growth. With that positive note, I want to end this session. I am ready for taking some questions from the audience. Can we open the floor for questions, please?
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, here are... Sir, here are four questions from various participants, sir. Sir?
Yeah, I am here. Please tell them.
Okay, sir. Sir, this is Angeline.
Okay.
This first question, mm-hmm. Now I'm going to read, sir.
Yeah.
Is intellectual property a part of corporate acquisition? It's question by Venkatesh Sherpuri, sir.
Yes, exactly. That is correct. See, corporate acquisition, I missed this point. It's a good question. A corporate acquisition, intellectual property is valued much more than the brick and mortar company. Company is having certain number of people, their orders, their execution of order, their delivery mechanism, and they are capable delivering goods and services. These are all one aspect, and they are all converted in the form of money to assess the value of the company. In addition to this, a few strong patents are intellectual property in general. Suppose the company need not be having patents alone. They can have a good presence in the market and trademark is well known. This adds up to the assessment manifold. It is, suppose the assessment is X times, I mean, suppose the assessment is X amount of money, then because of their strong patents and their strong presence in IP, the value can be multiple times, that is 4x, 5x times, the total value can increase because of their holdings in IP, which is true and seen in number of cases in Silicon Valley acquisitions and also in acquisitions in other places. There are small companies which are having maybe 10 people working for them, 10 people and 5 patents, they will be valued at $1 billion or $2 billion. So why it is because of their strength in the IP. So IP is separately valued, and which is adding multiple times value to the value of the company.
Thank you, sir. Next question, sir. This question by Akula Lakshmi. Is it possible to patent a machine learning mode?
Machine learning?
Yes, sir. Is it possible to patent a machine learning mode?
Yes. There are large number of patents coming up in machine learning. That is a buzzword now. Everybody is jumping into the bandwagon. And if you type artificial intelligence or machine learning in Google patents, for example, there can be any number of patent search engines. One of them is Google patent. So you type machine learning, there are hundreds, thousands maybe, patents available, publications, applications available right now, and they are all in stages of various stages of grant. But it is very much in vogue for getting patents. Every field of operation, every solution, they are applying machine learning nowadays. And machine learning is not new. It has been there for more than 30 years now. 1990 onwards, we are hearing the word machine learning. So in 30 years, we have reached certain stage where it can be applied in every field of operation, every solution to a problem, every solution to every problem, they are applying machine learning and trying to get patents. So you have to formulate your problem in such a way that it is novel and inventive, then you can get a patent.
Thank you, sir. Next question by Raghuram. What is the minimum qualification required to apply patent rights?
Minimum qualification. There is no minimum qualification. Any illiterate can also apply. You mean academic qualification?
No, or sir, just legal, he asked minimum qualification required to apply patent rights.
There is no minimum qualification as such. Anybody can apply. Even with zero education, one can apply for a patent.
Thank you,
only
sir.
They have to take the help of others.
Okay. Next question by again Akula Lakshmi. So, can I file a patent on artificial intelligence algorithm for inventions?
Yes, of course. I was telling the same thing about this machine learning. Machine learning, artificial intelligence, all are somewhat like synonyms. So it is not a broad thing like artificial intelligence is like an ocean. So in that ocean, how are you going to navigate the ocean? Are you going in a small boat, big boat, ship, or a steamliner, or a multi-deck, tourist ship? In what way you are going to negotiate that ocean is the question. Or are you going under the ocean and say going in a submarine? What method you are using, where you are using, and what problem you are solving? You take one problem, solve that problem using artificial intelligence, and that problem and that solution should not be repeated. It should be unique. First time you are solving the problem in this method of artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence has got so many methods. It is not one solution to all the problems. And same problem, different solutions are possible. Each solution is unique and novel. You can apply for a patent. I hope it's clear. I made it sound convincing. Is it okay if it is satisfied?
Yes, sir. Wonderful explanation, sir. Thank you so much for your useful information, sir.
Okay.
And then the session, ask me, take over the session.
Okay. Anybody else with questions?
No, sir. No more questions, sir.
No more questions.
All the questions finished. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. B. Manan, sir, for making us get thorough knowledge on intellectual property rights for business development and value addition. We are truly grateful to the time you have spent for us in sharing insightful information with us. And it's an honor to have been asked to offer a vote of thanks on the occasion of 5-day online workshop in our college's official channel. On behalf of my college and the entire management, here, I would like to convey my hearty gratitude to all the speakers for sharing their graceful words with us in today's session. I would like to thank once again to our resource person, Dr. B. Manan, sir, for your presence and enlightening us with your knowledge. Today's session was full of knowledge and interesting questions and interesting things. It's been my tribute to host all the members and audience of this session. I thank our Managing Director, Sir, Principal, Sir, Dr. K.C. Kulaipa, Sir, and I'm also very thankful to the entire participants as well as sponsors of this session. I'm sure that our college will continue to get significant provision from the diverse groups in the future. Thanks for all people who attended this session and made it successful. Keep learning, happy learning. Signing off, V. Yasmin. Thank you.
I also want to thank the management, principal, Dr. Kulaiappa, the convener, and all the other supporting staff and those who are in the organizing committee, and also Yasmin for good introduction and vote of thanks at the end. So thank you very much. I hope you have benefited by this interaction. We will look forward to seeing more interactions and more in future. Thank you very much.